Ladies and gentlemen, it's my immense pleasure to introduce Pablo to you.
Thank you very much, everybody, for coming. It's a big pleasure to be here for me today to talk about my papers, at least to talk about some of my papers that are related to punishment. I select this topic because it's, in certain sense, related to many other different fields. It's not pure economics, and it's some more related with sociology and political science, etc. No? So this is my idea of talking about punishment. Well, this is more or less the schedule of my talk, and I will go slowly, trying to explain easily all these concepts, even some of them are theoretical concepts, but I think are easy to follow. Well, let me start with this, with this punishment, no? Sorry. Let me start saying with this punishment. Punishment is the infliction or the imposition of a penalty as a retribution for an offense. Okay? Typically, this is punishment. Okay? Typically. But this is not exactly what I want to talk about. Okay? There are several levels of punishment. Punishment may be like soft, like this, no? Could be extreme. Could be extreme, could be public, could be private, no? You can give a lesson to someone in front of other people, you can do it in private with your kid, etc. But I don't want to talk about institutional punishment, so I don't want to talk about the police or the judge, no, I want to talk about spontaneous interaction, so random order. In the real life, you meet someone, and then you decide to punish him, okay? Okay, it's not a repeated game. So it's not the game I play with my kids. It's not that I give a lesson to my daughter because she's behaving properly or not. It's something random. In the middle of the street, I meet someone and I decide to make him, if he's making an offense to me or not, etc. So it's about individual punishment in random encounters, in one-shot game without common future. So there is no common future. This is the critical point. Okay? Well, example. Pablo, myself, sees someone smoking in the prohibited area here in Middlesex, so the question is, should I pay the cost of asking this person to quit smoking? Certainly I have to pay a cost. So I should go to him to ask him, sorry, could you quit smoking? Okay? And the question is, what are the benefits for me? There is a marginal, so the derivative, the second derivative of this guy's smoking, a marginal derivative of improvement. There is some future and uncertain improvement in the environment. And obviously there are the idea of giving a lesson, no? I can teach this guy, sorry, you are doing wrong, no? And I like to make the lesson, no? But I would get identical returns if Professor Pujal go to this guy to ask him to quit. Okay, so what for? I have to pay the cost. This is the typical public good problem. So in this situation, like in many situations in the life, when people face the decision, they realize that it's costly, but the benefits are a public good game, are public. So then the question is, why should I make the effort to punish someone? This is the question. Well, theory, if punishing someone is costly, okay, if punishment is costly, so I have to pay a cost to punish other person, then any rational guy shouldn't punish at all, never, okay? When punishment is costly and the expected benefits are not clear because it's not a repeated game, random interaction, etc., the theory said you shouldn't punish. What the Nash equilibrium says, I should not punish. And what is more important, under common knowledge of rationality, so I'm rational, you are rational, I know that you are rational, I know that you know that I am rational, and so on and so forth. I never expect to be punished. so I can smoke in the private area because no one is coming to Paris. Okay, this is the two traditions. So, but there are some people in the world that are special. Okay, we call them pro-social punishers. So there are some cooperators who are, say, proud of being cooperators, that are ready to pay a cost in order to reduce the benefit of defectors. So when I see someone smoking in the private area, I feel the pleasure of reducing this guy's benefit. Okay? We cannot explain that very well. There is a theory to explain this, which is this identity models. But basically, the idea is that some subjects are entitled with an extreme sense of identity, okay, that are going to pay the cost because they feel very good. So the question is that when they see the problem, they have to make the effort to punish someone, but they also see the benefit. They want growth, so they feel very good, no? Okay, finally they decide to punish. So today I have two questions for you. The first question is, do subjects anticipate this type of behavior, this type of irrational behavior? And the second question is, do subjects punish, although it's not rational? Are similar things, but not exactly the same thing. The first thing is about if I anticipate that other people is going to punish me. And the second question is about if I would punish under which condition, when punishment is more likely to appear. Okay, we'll start with extremely, giving the examples, I will explain a little bit what is an experiment in economics, because I guess that half of the people here do not know exactly what is this. So typically in an economic experiment, we have a student in a lab taking decisions. In most of the cases, the decisions are about a situation and a specific situation with equilibrium. So there is one, two, three, whatever equilibrium. So we expect people doing this or that. If when we observe what people is doing, so we observe the decision they are taking, we can say appreciate, we can check whether they are playing according to the theory or not. Okay? In many cases we are very successful because the theory works very well. And in other cases, nothing to say. Okay, behavioral economists build new models based on experimental results. Okay, experimental data are very good in the sense that you can get the data you want for your theory. So just make the model, bring the model to the lab, have people playing the game to see if they are playing according to what you expect or not. But obviously, there are limitations. The most important one is this idea of external validity. Okay, so what we see in the lab makes sense. So there is any relationship between what we observe in the lab and what we see in the real life? It's not that clear. There are tons of people working on this right now. Okay, why we think there are some problems? Why makes sense to think about the problem about external validity? The first thing is that the people who are playing in the lab are special people. First thing, they are subject invited to the lab to earn money. So are special people because they were invited to earn money. So why did they come? Because they wanted to get money. The second thing is that we always have information about those that finally decide to come to the lab. So that means that we don't have information about who didn't. So this is a kind of self-selection problem, no? So we have self-selected because the money, more self-selected because they decide to show up, to come here. And obviously the environment is very artificial. This is something, there are very huge differences between psychology and economics in these three things, okay? And the big difference is about real money, we pay them for taking decisions, and the money they get is contingent to the decisions they take. So if I play a prisoner dilemma when I have to select between cooperate or not, and I decide to cooperate, and she decides defect, I will earn zero. And she will earn a lot of money. And it's real. So my benefits are contingent to my decision and the other people's decision. And typically, we are very serious with these anonymous decisions. So we have a lot of people in the same lab. They play each other randomly. They don't know who are playing. And we have a lot of control of keeping anonymity. Okay, just to people taking decisions directly and not be very concerned about if the other guy is going to punish him later on or whatever. No, so decisions are anonymous. When we say double blind means that even the experimentalist does not know what the student did. Okay, this is more complicated, more anonymity. Well, this is a typical lab. I select the Max Planck Institute because it's one of the very old ones, Werner Gut. And also a kind of tribute to him, no? Because he published the famous Ultimatum game paper, and I will talk a little bit about this game later on. So this is the Werner Gut lab in Germany. It's quite big. It's in the middle of a... There are two labs, one is in the institute, it is outside the city, and the other is in a mall in the center of the city, to play with ordinary people. Okay, all in all, in many cases, experiments have been replicated all around the world with quite successful results. That means that the students are special, definitely, but they are identically special in London than in Melbourne, in Madrid, than in Santa Barbara. Okay? And usually, experimental results are based more on treatment effect rather than in baseline data. So typically, we run two treatments, baseline and the treatment, and then we check the difference. So this is in favor of neat results. Okay, the first part of my talk is about if subjects change their behavior under the threat of being punished. I will start with an extremely simple experiment. I did this experiment like 5 years ago with Stefania Ottone. But then she got pregnant, she had a lot of problems, so we stopped the project. And now the kid is okay, and it's 3 years ago, 3 years old, so we will write the paper now. The testing is a beautiful paper. Probably we arrive a bit late, 5 years later. But the idea is, you will see, it's extremely, I think, clean. This is the idea. We have a dictator game, where one individual randomly is selected in the room to be dictator, and he is matched with another person, which would be receiver. So you have dictators and recipients. Okay, it's randomly decided. So you just, and the computer say, okay, you are dictator. Not dictator, you are player type A. And then you are player type B. So then dictators are informed that they have to share some amount of money between themselves and the recipients. So you have a pie, say $10, and then you have to share the money. You have to divide the money in the way you want under complete anonymity condition with other person which is in the room. You have no idea which is this person, another person in the room. Okay? So this is the standard dictator game. So it's to solve a location problem in anonymity conditions. What we expect? Clearly, what we expect if the size of the pie is positive, so it's not an empty set of money, it's money, what we should expect is that the dictator will keep everything and will pass nothing. Okay? If the dictator is rational, what we should observe is that he will keep the whole money for him if there is money to divide. Okay? We have two treatments. In the treatment one, we have exactly this game. We have people taking the decision in the lab to divide some money with other person in the lab, treatment one. And in treatment two, we have exactly the same thing, with the only difference is that there is someone who is observing decisions, is the third party guy, observing decisions, and is allowed to punish. How? A third party is invited to observe the game and entitled to punish the dictator if he doesn't like the choice. he has to pay 1 bax per 3 bax of punishment. It's not tip top. So if you decide to punish this guy 2, then you have to pay 2, and then he will be punished in 6. What that means 6? That he's going to lose 6. Okay, if imagine that the final payoff for the dictator was 10, after the punishment stage, if the other guy invests 2, then the benefits of the dictator will be reduced from 10 to 4, because the other guy paid 3 to punish him 6. Sorry, paid 2 to punish him 6. Okay? Well, so this is the baseline, standard dictator game. This is the treatment, standard dictator game with monitoring, with policeman. And the theoretical predictions are obvious. If the pi is positive, the dictator will keep everything and will pass nothing. If the pi is positive and the price is positive, so it's not tip top, what we expect is that the dictator is going to keep everything for him, the recipient is going to get 0, and the third party is not going to punish. Okay? It's obvious. What for I'm going to punish? So I went to the lab, and the random machine say you are player C, you have to see what is the other guy seeing. You get 10 bucks just for being there. What for you are going to spend money to teaching lesson to someone that you don't know anything about him? You don't know who is him. You are not going to see him in the rest of your life. So what for you are going to? Only if you are the super cooperator guy that you want to teach him a lesson, no? This is the idea, no? Well, results. What we find? Okay, when we got that, we say, bah, nothing. When we saw that, they say, okay, nothing. There is no difference. So you see that there are a lot of subjects giving 0 in both treatments, with punishment, without punishment. So 50% of the people said, okay, give me the money. And I don't mind if he would like to punish me or not. I will take the money. Very few of them behave fairly. Fairly that means sharing equal split, okay? So at the first sight, they say, okay, there is no result at all. So, no, it doesn't work at all. But, then we divide men and women. This is men in the free condition. This is woman in the free condition. That means that in the free condition, so without any policeman, you see that many women keep the whole pie for them. So when they are in a completely anonymous setting, say you see that many of these Italian girls from Milano girl, I cannot say woman, Italian Milano girls, they are not very nice. But you see that men, Italian men, are quite nice guys. Okay, you have very few people giving the equal split, but okay, there are very few behaving rationally. What happened under punishment, under threat of punishment? Then automatically men, in front of the police, I will behave rationally. What happened with women? Exactly the opposite. They behave socially. Under the threat of being observed, they behave socially. Well, in the baseline, men are prosocial, women less social. In the treatment, men become antisocial, women behave socially. Policy implications? Education. Education in the school. Okay? Organization, etc., etc. Okay, this is a very sophisticated paper I did with Kike Fatah from East Anglia University and Pablo Guillén in Sydney, all of Spanish. And what we did is we bring people to the lab to play a game which is very standard public good game. In the public good game, people is endowed with some money, say 10 euros, and they have to decide if they want to keep the money for them in their pocket or if they want to invest the whole money or just a fraction of the money in a common pot. Okay, so it's like a price on a dilemma, but in continuous time. So you can put whatever, the amount. It's not cooperate or defect. You can cooperate with everything, with a little bit, 50%, 70%, whatever you want. Every single amount of money you put in the pot, will generate 50% to the society. That means if you put one unit in the pot, every single member of the society will receive half of the unit, regardless of this guy was or not cooperative. So the idea is, if we are four people, typically this experiment is done with four, although there are papers with three, with five, okay, but typically with four people, you have four people, each of them is end up with some money, like 50 ICUs, is experimental currency units. They are end up with some money. They have to decide simultaneously, and of course they don't see each other, they don't know who are the members of the team, because there are 30 people playing at the same time in the lab, in different groups, so you don't know anything about your partner. You know you are four. All of them, they have exactly the same rules, and then they have to decide the fraction of the money they want to put in the common pot. Obviously, if everybody contributes all, okay, automatically there is a lot of money for the society, okay? Because everything is double. So whatever you put is double in terms of the society. But the Nash equilibrium says that every single individual should realize that if everybody is very nice and cooperative and with flowers, all of them are very nice, but he behaves selfishly, he will earn not only the money in the pocket, but also the whole society pie, except his own contribution. Okay? So the theory said that people should defect. Okay? And this is exactly what we see in most of the experiments. We see that people are starting being very nice at the beginning, in the first round, but very soon they learn that it's impossible to maintain that. And then most of them behave rationally. So they learn to play the Nash equilibrium, that means to contribute zero to the public good game. This is exactly the tragedy of the commons. Okay? It would be ideal if everybody cares about the, if you see something in the park, to make your own contribution to keep it everything clean. But it's quite impossible, because this is a public good game. It is much better if I don't take the piece of paper and I don't pick it and put it in the rubbish, could be ideal. It's much better if I see that and say, okay, the next person will do for me. Huh? What? Well, we make a new treatment. We make a treatment in which we have automata. So we have computers that are playing as players, and they play the most simple rule in the Bible, in the Torah, and everywhere. Tit for tat. Okay? That means that every single subject is informed that if just one of them defect, automatically the automaton will change to defector. If everybody's contributing very nice and everybody's cooperative, etc., the automaton exactly will play that. So it will be very nice. So it's the idea of the automata is like you. If you are nice, it will be nice. If you are bad, it will be very bad. Okay? Terribly bad. So it's a bit more sophisticated than that, but to put it simple. So the automata would cooperate until any member of the group defect. Okay? If it's happened, automatically he will defect until the end of the game. Okay? We have the baseline, no automatas, and we have three treatments. We taught them a number between 0 and 3 automatas, okay, will be in your session. If there is 0 automatas, that means that you will play with humans. If there are 2, means that you play 2 human, 2 automata. If there are 3, means that you are the only human. Okay? So, would we inform subjects that a number between 0 and 3 automata will be in the room? in their group, sorry. And it will be determined by the computer. So you don't know the number of automata. Okay? I will show you data only from session with zero automata. Okay? So we have baseline where they know they are humans, and we have the zero automata sessions where there are no any single automata, but they don't know. Okay? But they can learn. Because if you start to play in the group and then you see that someone in your group defect, and then automatically the automata is not triggered, that means that there is no any automata in your group. Okay? Well, result. They play 10 times. Repeat it. Bam, bam, bam. Okay, the first round, what we have? Okay, we have that some people, there is like a hub of operators. Some defectors, and they start to learn very fast. So what we see at the end is most of the people is here. Okay, this is the typical problem of the tragedy of commons. People learn to be selfish. What happened in the automata treatment with zero automata? They start everybody cooperating because they are really scared. Okay, and then some of them they start to realize that there are no automata. Okay, there are no automata in the groups. They start to defect and say, okay, good. So, well, stop. Now, think that the theoretical prediction for that game are extremely complicated because you have to form beliefs about beliefs, etc., etc. So it's not an easy job. But I can assure to you that after round 10, every single subject was aware that in their group there were not any single automata. Okay, all of them. We have a lot of tests in the paper to check this because we were very lucky. And in all sessions, we had someone that couldn't avoid to make the decision to try just to see what happened. So it was impossible to believe that there is any automaton involved in their session. Impossible to believe that. So then the same people play again another 10 rounds. Okay, same people, same group, same everything. So, if I play for 10 rounds without any automata, means that I will not have any other automaton during the session, okay? Exactly the same. What we have, even stronger. So what we have is that, in the baseline, we have exactly what we expect in round 11. People is not cooperating at all. But in the automata treatment, we have even stronger results. Okay? Even stronger results. So, the threat of being punished persists even when it's not believable at all. It's impossible to believe you have any automata in your own. Impossible. You should be completely stupid to believe that. Obviously, this is not rational. But the interesting thing is that it works. It works. Then, probably everybody is remembering now this, the boogeyman is coming. Okay, why we have this with the kids? To sustain cooperation, it's efficient. Just the threat of being punished is efficient, it's socially efficient, even if it's not rational. Okay, it's completely irrational. Well, now we'll go to more sophisticated environments. I will start with the ultimatum game. And the ultimatum game is very similar to the dictator game with the difference that the two players have to take decisions. So it's exactly the same as an allocation problem involving the division of a pie, okay, of size m, where player one, randomly selected, proposes the division of the pie, okay, keeping some amount of money for him, for the recipient, and the rest for himself. And he has, and then player two, typically it's a sequential game, player two decides whether to accept the division, and then it is implemented like that. So if he offered like 2 10 minus 2, 2 8, and he decides to accept, he will take 2, and the boss will receive 8. Or if he doesn't like, he can say, no, I am not going to accept the offer. So then both of them, they got zero. This is exactly, if you go to Marc and Spencer, you see something, this is an ultimatum offer. You see something, you like this dress, you see the price, it's an ultimatum offer. If you like it, you take it, and Marc and Spencer get something and you get the dress. If you don't like, you just go back and then both of you lose the business. Okay? This is ultimatum offer. Okay, what the theory said? Obvious. Given that player two would accept any positive offer, because whatever is better than zero, then player one will offer almost zero. Okay? So if I'm pretty sure that you are going to accept whatever salary, what I should do? Offer you epsilon. Okay? Epsilon is enough.
I remember that one.
Of course. Well, so this ultimatum game that was introduced by Bernard Wood, this guy from Germany in 1982, has caused a huge impact in the literature. Not only in economics, but also in anthropology, in social science, in general, political science, etc. And then the first question is that if fair subject accept unfair offers. This is the first question. Okay? It is very easy to understand that if m is close to zero, so if you are offering me something like epsilon, then the recipient, okay, perhaps is not going to accept. What happens is that he can pay a cost, m, to punish you. So you offer me something which is for me ridiculous, 10%, and then I decide, okay, I prefer to pay 10%, okay, to teach you a lesson that you cannot go in the life of in this wage, no? It's not moral or something like that. So rejection of unfair offers are typically interpreted like pro-social punishment. So when people receive unfair offers, then most of them would reject that just to teach the lesson to the proposer. Okay? Well, I buy this explanation, but only 50%. Okay, I think there are other more nice explanations and fun explanations. I will go to the other explanations. Okay, so typically, the ultimatum game is not implemented simultaneously in a lab. It's not implemented because it's very costly. Imagine you have a pie, which is in, say, 10 bucks, so you can make offers like 1, 2, 3, from 0, 1, 2, 3, until 10. So then you have 10, the individual make an offer, say 3, for instance, like 3 for the proposer, 7 for me. And then the recipient answers yes or no. But then I only know that Anna rejects 3, but I don't know anything about 4, anything about 2. So there is very few information with the sequential method. So we are a bit reluctant to play that because it's very costly, you spend a lot of money, and the only thing you have is answers conditional to proposals. But you don't know anything about the rest of the thing. So then, what we do is to change the game to a simultaneous game. In the simultaneous game, everything is identical, with the only difference that at the moment you make the decision of whether accept or reject, you don't know anything about the offer. You know a potential offer, but you really don't know anything about the offer. So what you do is to sign a contract. And in the contract, you establish which is your minimum acceptable offer. Okay, so you are going to play the game, there are 10 bucks, this guy is going to make you an offer, to how to divide, and then you have to say, okay, I could not accept anything below 23. Okay, 23%, or whatever. Okay, so this, then the first mover plays against a contract. Okay, not against a person. Okay, not fair-minded individual will fix a minimum acceptable offer close to the theory, to zero. So if you are completely rational, you are playing this game, you are in the lab, what you should say? You are not going to teach lesson to anybody. You just say whatever epsilon higher than zero. You maximize the probability of getting something. In fact, if you don't behave in that way, you are a bit strange guy, no? Trying to teach him lessons to computers and these things makes no sense, I think. And very fair-minded individuals will select a MAU close to 50%. I would never accept something below 50% because it's unfair. Okay? This is the typical explanation. Well, I have done several papers in this field. And in fact, this is my second experimental paper. It was published in 2006. And I will focus in the last paper. In the last paper, we have, for every single participant, we have minimum acceptable offer, but also we have time discount. What is time discount? Is the value the person gives to the future. So if I offer you £100 in 1 month, or £100 plus one in 2 months, what do you prefer? 100 in 1 month or 101 in 2 months? Mostly, most of the people will say 1 month. Okay, 100 and 105, 1 month. 100, 110. Okay, 100 and 120. And at some moment, you will say, stop, I will wait for the second month. Okay, this is the discount factor. This is the value you give to the future. Typically, people which is future-minded, they give a lot of value to the future, they need very few money to wait. But those who are only present-oriented, kids, you have to offer them a lot of money in the future because they prefer the cake today. Please, please give me the cake today. Okay? Okay, this is quite a special experiment. Because we did an experiment in the lab, we went to houses. We went to 750 houses, randomly selected, etc., etc. Yeah, it's a wonderful data set. I hopefully get a lot of good paper published with this. I have that now. I already have 2, but I expect to have 5 or 6 because we did a huge effort to get this data. 755 ordinary people playing games. It's ordinary people playing at their homes, double blind, real money, etc., etc. We have discounted factor, capture how subject value the future. Higher DD means low preference for the future. So, present-minded people. And then the question is, do present-oriented subjects, high DD, punish similarly to those who are low DD? So passionate and impatient people punish similarly, okay? And why we have this question? We have this question because this makes a lot of sense, okay? This high DD subject, we have low preferences for the future. If you are present-oriented individual, for you, every single encounter in the life is like a one-shot game. You just think today. You don't think about the consequences. So what we think is that if you are a really present-oriented individual, then you will play every single situation in the life as a one-shot game. So that means you will never see the consequences. You just play the game, get the money, and let's see what happens tomorrow, no? But what happened with this future-minded individual? They will consider everything in the life as a the life game. So if they play the ultimatum in the lab, they say, okay, but if I give this guy a lesson, probably in the future, I will mate with him another time, and then my investment today will become in something tomorrow. And even if I give a strong lesson to this guy, probably this guy is going to change and also teach their relative, their family, and the whole society, blah, 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 blah. Okay, you need a really future-minded guy to make these kind of things, no? Okay? That is the reason we started to work with this, like 4 years ago. Well, these are the results. We have 2 measures of passion. We have short run and long run. Short run means, what do you prefer? $5 today or $6 or $5 tomorrow? £5 today or six? £5 today or 7 tomorrow. This is short run. Okay? Long run is in 6 months or in 7 months. Okay, and then what we have here is minimum acceptable offer. Okay? So we have here that impatient individual, in short, long, and combining, that means the result is always the same, are very likely to reject an ultimatum game. Impatient individuals are very likely to reject. Okay? This is exactly the opposite that we were thinking. What we thought here is that future-minded individuals are going to punish in the ultimatum game because they think in the future. Okay? And what we got exactly is the opposite, is that patient individuals who think in the future, accept whatever, they are rational. But impatient individuals, those who don't think at all about the future, reject everything. Okay? And then how we can manage that? Okay. I think that the explanation is quite simple. This result is against the moral argument. It's against the moral argument. It's that people do not reject unfair offers in the ultimatum game because it's fair. In the pro-social punishment, it's just impulsiveness. It's in favor of psychologists against economists. Okay? People reject offer because now, right now, I feel it's unfair. Unfair in the very short run argument, not in the long time idea of repeated games. This paper is... This is the last paper. It's a bit more complicated. So, we have subjects playing one-shot public good games in groups of 4 people. So we have, in the lab, groups of 4 people playing a standard public good game. After showing the result, so they play the game. All of them, they got the result in a piece of paper saying what they contribute, the other people contribute, and their benefit, etc., etc. They have full information. They are entitled to punish the other individuals. So we ask them, we don't say the word punish, but we say, would you like to reduce the benefit of other person? Okay, this is what we ask them. You have to pay €1 to reduce them €3. So it's important to remark that they were explicitly invited to do this. Then we have time discount, as we explained before, only long term. We didn't have short term. So we have, for every single participant, sorry, I didn't mention that we have 160 people, ordinary people, etc. This is not lab experiment. It's different experiment. For every single individual, we have decision in the public good game, so we know if they are cooperator or not, between 0 and 10. 10 means that he's extremely cooperative, and 0 means that he's a defector. Okay, he kept the whole money for him. We have punishment. So after receiving the information about the contribution of everybody in his group, he decides whether to punish or not, to whom, if I want to punish this guy or that guy, etc. That guy means a number, no? The participant in your group, number 2. And time discount, long-term time discount. We have 160 people, ordinary people, in session of 32 participants, adult labs that we did in village, a bit crazy experiment, and we want to explore punishing behavior of cooperators and defectors, okay? And time discount. So we insist with our idea. Our idea is, if people think about punishment, we should observe something related to time discount, because it makes no sense. No? If you are a punishing guy, you should punish. If not, no. But now, with the difference with the previous experiment, we have that the decision of punishing and the decision of being social or not cooperator are different decisions, so we can disentangle. Okay. This is patient individual. Patients means that we divide the sample in two, the more patient and the more impatient individual. These are the more patient individual, those who really think in the future. And what we have here is their level of cooperation. If they cooperate very few, they are defectors. If they cooperate a lot, they are cooperators. Okay? Very nice, extremely nice people. And here what we have is the partner level of cooperation. The partner level of cooperation. Okay? In the group, the partner. And then what we have is that the higher my level of cooperation, okay, the higher my level of punishment for defectors. You see, this is zero is defector, this is cooperator. You see that cooperators never punish cooperators. But cooperator punish a lot of defectors. Okay, makes sense. Prosocial punishment. I'm a social guy, I think in the future. So, given that I'm social and I think in the future and I think that everything is a repeated game, I punish you to teach you a lesson. Okay? Makes sense. What happened with impatient people? Exactly the opposite. This is the other half of the population, impatient individuals. What we have for them? We have that the higher the level of defection, so when they are defector, the higher the probability of punishing other defectors. So, okay? So, while cooperators punish defectors when they are patient, the impatient defectors punish other defectors. Okay, this is pure competitive preference. This is kill the rival. Okay, I want to earn more money than you. When we leave the lab, I want to have more money here. I will kill you, nothing else. Well, this makes sense. This makes a lot of sense. In some, patient and cooperative subjects are more likely to punish socially. Good? Impatient defector punish other defectors, which is pure competitive preferences. Impatient cooperator will not punish, since there is no future for them. What for they are going to punish? And patient defector do not spend their money on punishment. They are defectors. Okay? Well, to finish, I will go back to our paper I mentioned before. And oops, this is one my second experimental paper I did. And it's about, I did the experiment in Madrid, outside Madrid, in a very poor area from UC people. And we have gypsy people playing against gypsy people. This is important thing. So they are playing randomly, anonymously, etc. But all of them were gypsies, and was obvious. So we have like 50 gypsy people in the same room, playing randomly, but gypsy against gypsy. Okay. Then they play simultaneous game. All participants were gypsies, and everything is in group. Okay, it's not playing against strangers. And what we found, amazing, they played in Asia Philippines. They accept almost everything. They don't punish each other. This result is unique in the literature. It's the only paper, that is the reason I got a lot of citations, that someone has found a population playing the Nash equilibrium. And probably it's not because they are very smart. It's just in-group effect. What for I'm going to punish another gypsy like me? So they accept any offer, any positive offer. And if you go here, there are only two, three guys who really expect, who put in a contract, I would accept only the equal experiment, which is amazing. This is the only, when you have to run an experiment, you have always to compute ex ante the amount of money you are going to spend. Because you have to pay people, no? Typically, you use probabilistic rules more or less to calculate, okay? After this experience, I never make probabilistic rules. I prefer to put myself in the worst case scenario and to bring the all possible money. Perhaps they are able to keep the whole money, exactly what happened here. They didn't lose any single euro. So I went there with some money times the number of people, and I left with all the money off. They play strategically, very strategic. So in some, you see, do not punish each other. This is consistent with the theory. And this outcome is almost inexistent all around the world. Conclusion is that even in artificial environments like economic labs, subjects punish each other. In most of the cases, punishing is not rational, especially for big names, a stranger, random partners, etc. Although the dominant strategy is not punish, but people punish. The threat of being punished may be an efficient device to coordinate subjects in social outcomes against the Nash equilibrium, but in many other cases may cause an intended effect, like this removal of intrinsic motivation. This may be dangerous. Okay? Sometimes there are some people that is, who is willing to help, but if you put punishment, then they are reluctant. Punishing behavior seems to be related to time discount, but the link is unclear. In ultimatum game environment, where there is no efficiency, which is very important, there is no efficiency at all, impatient subjects are more likely to punish. But in public good game environment, where efficiency is an issue, the previous result holds only for defectors. In fact, patient cooperators, okay, are very likely to punish, driven by moralistic goals. And that's all. Thank you.